Hello people, it's my birthday today. What's a birthday celebration without lights? Especially when I love them. So let's build an interesting project this week using LED lights. Take a look. I'm going to show you how I constructed this LED cube. I'm not sure how you guys see it, but it's lit up like a birthday cake. Now let's blow the candles out. The LED cube is nothing but a three-dimensional array of LEDs to light up in different forms and patterns. It's a cool piece of tech that you can put it up for a show or make it dance to your beats. It's not all fun, since I see this as an opportunity to learn or better your soldering, circuit designing, programming, and 3D printing skills. A lot of people around the world have already constructed such cubes using colored LED lights in various sizes. Though I would like to construct an RGB LED cube, I think I'll start up with a simple one color LED cube to gain some experience. I was super impressed and inspired by Char's project from Instructables. You should check it out if you got the time. I'm going to construct a 8x8x8 LED cube, which is nothing but 8 rows, 8 columns and 8 layers of LEDs. That's 512 LEDs in all. Now the most important item is the LED. Pick the smallest size so that the cube is compact. Also, it's better to get the diffused LEDs over translucent ones because the translucent ones scatter light and it is not very appealing. I have picked up a pack of 1000 diffused LEDs, of which I will be using 512. We have to be able to control each of the LEDs independently, only then we can make interesting patterns. I am going to use an Arduino Pro Mini microcontroller development board, but this board has only 21 I/O pins to control the LEDs. But we can build a multiplexing circuit to drive all of the 512 LEDs through the 21 I/O pins. Before we get into the design of the driver circuit, let's build the structure for the LED cube. It's very important that we get the symmetry right for the cube to look good. So let's get a jig ready that will help us maintain symmetry. I'm going to 3D print a 120x120x2mm base for constructing the cube. I'm going to use this to create each layer of LEDs, which will be about 64 LEDs per layer. Now I need to space the LEDs uniformly across the board. Since the cathode pin is about 17mm long, leaving 2mm for soldering, I'm going to space the holes 15mm apart. Let's start the 3D printing. I'm first arranging the LEDs in a row and shorting the cathode. Similarly, I'm going to arrange 8 rows of LEDs with their cathodes shorted. Once done, I have one cathode pin and 64 anode pins. This forms one layer. Arranging 8 such layers on top of each other will make it unstable and the structure will deform. So I'm going to give it some additional support. There are quite a few ways of doing this, and one such way is to use silver plated copper wire. But since I don't have this with me, I'm going to try out a crude method. Stretching the soldering wires stiffens it, so I'm going to use that for support. Apply some soldering on the cathode pins before using the soldering wire to give support. Hopefully, using it in the center and sides should give the cube the strength it needs. We will need about 16 wires, and it's very important that we get this part right. I'm going to straighten out the anode pins to make them symmetrical. The LEDs may get damaged at times due to the soldering heat, so it's better to check them after constructing every layer. Once done, the layers can be assembled on top of each other, and this time the anode pins can be soldered. At the end, we should have 64 anode pins and one cathode pin per layer. With these 72 pins, we should be able to control each of the LEDs in this cube. So we need a support structure to assemble these layers on top of each other. Let's quickly design and print the support structure. Looks like I made a mistake. I was little too enthusiastic and did not check whether the anode pins aligned with each other. I should have bent the anode pins by 2mm so that each layer can be soldered to one another and a straight line can be formed. Since I did not do this, I will have to manually bend all the pins that I have soldered, and this could affect the symmetry in the end. But when you construct it, take due care to not make the same mistake. Now the construction is complete, we will have to work on the driver circuit. Like I mentioned in the beginning, we will need 72 I/O pins from the controller, but that's a luxury we can't afford. So let's build a multiplexing circuit and reduce the number of pins. Let's look at an example. Let's take a flip-flop IC. This is a D-type flip-flop. Let's not worry about the technicalities at this point. The fundamental job of this IC is to remember 8 bits of data which appears on the input pins D0 to D7. There are two pins for the power supply. Q0 to Q7 are the output pins. There is a pin called output enable pin. It is an active low pin. That is, only when you make it 0 will the input data appear in the output pins. There is also a clock pin. Let's see why we need it. Now I have fixed the IC on a breadboard and set the input values to 1010, 1010 with 8 LEDs connected to the output. Now the LED is on or off based on the input. Let me change the input to 1010, 1011 and check out the output. I don't see any change with the LEDs, but when I send a low to high pulse through the clock pin, the output changes based on the new input. We are going to use this concept to develop our driver circuit board. But this IC can remember only 8 bits of data, so we are going to use a total of 8 such ICs to support 64 inputs. We will see the circuit design in our next video. Until then, this is Satyam and I thank you for watching this video.